You're the same God. This is who we worship tonight. He's the same, he's the same. Oh God, how I need you. How I need you. You freed the captives. You're freeing hearts right now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You touched the lepers. I feel your touch right now. You are the same God. You are the same God. Every change, oh, forever same. We feel you now. You're the same God. You're the same God, yeah. How we need you now, yeah. I'm calling on the Holy Spirit. Almighty river, come and fill me again.
Let that be your prayer tonight.
Come and fill me again. Come and fill me. Come and fill me
If I knew then what I know now, I wouldn't have doubted you. I wish I could tell my younger self just to have faith.
Good morning, church, especially Michael DeMond right here. We are going to start our service in about 15 minutes. Thank you for braving the weather. Good snowball weather out there. Just suggesting something after church. But I will see you here in about 14 and a half minutes.
In every step looking back, never once did you let me go. And no matter what the future holds, you're working for my good. My life is full of miracles, the stories that I could tell. All that you've healed, all that you've done, I can't forget. So even if my life doesn't go the way I plan or how I hope, our history has shown you've never failed me.
Oh, got nothing to hide. I've got nothing to lose. There's no reason to fear, 'cause I've got nothing to prove to you. Just as I am, I come into your arms, I run. But with the blood of your only son, now and forever adopted in love, I'm yours forever. Is that your prayer? Yours forever. Yours forever. was forever God.
Hey, good morning. Just a quick reminder, we're going to start our worship service in about 5 minutes. Please start making your way to your seats. Get cozy, and we'll see you then.
Every day that I would live before a word is on my tongue, God, you know it all together. You're the one I come from. You're the one I come from.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Strength to face the day.
Good morning, everybody. Please stand and sing with me. This is a little song with about prayer. If you know it, sing along. Your heart is aching, you got trouble in the making, and you ask if I'll be praying for you, please. And in keeping with convention, I'll say yes with good intention to pray later, making mention of your needs. But since we have this moment here at heaven's door, we should start knocking now. What are we waiting for? Let us pray, let us pray. Everywhere and every way, every moment of the day, it is the right time. For the Father above, He is listening with love, and He wants to answer us, so let us pray. The Spirit moving, prompting, prodding, and behooving. There's no time to be losing. Let us pray. Let the Father hear us saying what we need to be conveying. Even while this song is playing, let us pray. And just because we say the words Amen doesn't mean this conversation needs to end. Let us pray, let us pray. Everywhere and every way, every moment of the day, it is the right time. Let us pray without end, and when we finish, start again. Like breathing out and breathing in, oh, let us pray. Let us approach the throne of grace with confidence, as our prayers draw us near to the one who knows our needs before we even call His name. Let us pray, let us pray. Everywhere and every way, every moment of the day, it is the right time. For the Father above, He is listening with love, and He wants to answer us. So let us pray, let us pray. Every moment, every way, every moment of the day, it is the right time. Let us pray without end, when we finish, start again. Like breathing out and breathing in, no, oh, let us pray. That nations of the earth are shaken. There is no power that can match His grace. Lift up your head, lift up your eyes to see. All of creation has been waiting, longing for sons and daughters to declare His truth. Lift up your head, lift up your voice and sing. He is the light shining in the darkness. He is the hope, hope for all the nations. He is the light, He is the light for all the world to see. I feel the faith across the earth is rising. We prophesy about His kingdom come. Just in heaven, all across the earth. He is the light shining in the darkness. He is the hope, hope for all the nations. He is the light, He is the light for all the world to see. Great is the Lord. Great, great is the Lord. Praise His name. Praise His name. Great is the Lord. Praise His name. Praise His name. He is the light shining in the darkness. He is the hope, hope for all the nations. He is the light. He is the light for all the world to see. Sing it again. He is the light shining in the darkness. He is the hope, hope for all the nations. He is the light. He is the light for all the world to see.
Morning and welcome to worship. We are so happy to see you this morning here in person and also online. Just a quick reminder, if you are worshiping with us online, you can go ahead and use that chat feature. We have a staff member in the chat talking back to you guys. So it's Shay, by the way. I don't know if it says her name on there, but it's Shay. She's there. So if you have any prayer requests or anything, you can tell her in the chat. We have a few announcements. First things first, if you are new with us this morning, we have a gift for you at the Hub. And if you're new with us online, let us know online so we can make sure to get a gift for you when you come in person. And also, at the bottom of your bulletin, there's a Connect card. You can use that, let us know how we can pray for you, all that fun stuff. But at this point in time, the ushers are going to come forward for the morning offering. And then if you're worshiping online, you can give at our website, www.threerivers.church. If you're new with us, don't feel pressure to give. We have regular people who give regularly. A few announcements this morning. First things first, cabin fever is a little bit less than 2 weeks away. So if you want to volunteer for cabin fever, there's a sign-up sheet back there. It's on February 4th from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m., and you can volunteer for different shifts or what have you. Another thing you can do, too, if you're like, oh, I can't make it to cabin fever that day, but I really wish I could do something, we have a little flyer back there about donating a gift basket. These are used for our raffles for cabin fever, and they're really, really important because they allow us to send invites to people for art camp, things like that. So if you're willing to put together a little gift basket, or if you want to know more about what that requires, there's this lovely flyer back there with some beautiful steps, only 2 steps, super simple, and you can get that right back there at the Hub. Also, we are launching a bunch of new life groups. There are 6 new life groups. So you can get a pamphlet at the back door when you leave today. It looks just like this. These life groups are launching now through March. And we tried to put something on there that would pertain to everyone and would also be able to hit any time of the week. So some of them meet on weekdays, some of them meet on a Saturday, some of them meet on a Sunday, things like that. So make sure you grab that. If you have any questions about that, go ahead and send me an email or you can just talk to me here. And lastly, dinner church is January 24th. If you're planning on coming to dinner church, you can let Nathan know. He's right there. And yeah, you should come. It's going to be really great. We're going to talk about prayer. There's going to be soup. It's going to be delicious. But with that, I think Christy Hughes is now going to come up and do our scripture reading.
Good morning, church. This morning's reading is Psalm 27 of David. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? One thing I ask from the Lord, this is only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. For in the day of trouble, he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his sacred tent and set me high upon a rock. Then my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me. At his sacred tent, I will sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord. Hear my voice when I call, Lord. Be merciful to me and answer me. My heart says of you, seek his face. Your Lord, I will seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my helper. Do not reject me or forsake me, God my Savior. The word of the Lord.
At this time, the kids are welcome to head back for Children's Church. And as we continue in worship, I'd ask you to just posture yourself in an attitude of worship, and the altar is open if you want. I would encourage you to stand and sing, but take whatever posture works the best for you and allows you to sing and connect with the Lord.
Christ is my reward and all of my devotion. Now there's nothing in this world that could ever satisfy. Through every trial, my soul will sing, no turning back. I've been set free. Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I need. Christ, my all in all, the joy of my salvation, and this hope will never fail. Heaven is our home. Through every storm, my soul will sing, Jesus is here. To God be the glory. Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I need, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back.
The cross before me,
the cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. You're everything I need. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. extravagant. Your friendship is intimate. I find I'm moving to the rhythms of your grace. Your fragrance is intoxicating in our secret place. Your love is extravagant. Spread wide in the arms of Christ is the love that covers sin. No greater love have I ever known. You considered me your friend, captured my heart again. Secret place, Jesus, your love is extravagant. Spread wide in the arms of Christ is the love that covers sin. No greater love have I ever known. You considered me your friend. Spread wide in the arms of Christ is the love that covers sin. No greater love have I ever known. You considered me friend, captured my heart again. Captured my heart again. Your love extravagant. Your love is extravagant. Creating me a clean. Renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God. And renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me, and restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me. Let's sing that again. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me.
Cast me not away.
Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me, and restore unto me the joy of my salvation, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me.
Lord, we ask that you would come and restore a clean heart within all of us. And as we continue on with our worship service today, and we hear from you, we hear your word, please be with Pastor Kyle as he brings that, open up our hearts to be sensitive to what your Holy Spirit is saying to us. Thank you for being here with us today. We love you, Lord. Amen.
Good morning. We've had such kind of delightfully warm weather here this last week. It was tempting to think that maybe winter was over. It's not. Glad to be with you this morning. I know quite a few of you probably are watching us online today as well, and we're glad that you could be there, and thankful for our awesome tech team that makes streaming possible so that those of you that are home can still enjoy and participate in worship today. We're on our third week of a series called People Who Pray, and we're starting our year with this series. It is kind of like it's a praxis series. It's something that we can put into use. It's a series that has a lot, we're giving a lot of tools out, and we're talking about how and why we pray to start the new year. And I've enjoyed it. I've been learning, and it's been fun to share with you and have some good conversations with many of you and pray with many of you. And I think it's a good way to start the year. I'm kind of sensing from the Lord, at least for me, that prayer is going to be a big theme for 2023 in my life. And we've been kind of asking that question, like what would change, what would shift if we really embraced the opportunity and the invitation from Jesus to pray? What would change in your relationships? What would change at work? Will change in our attitudes or our emotions or how we perceive life or what God could and will do in our lives. You know, we're coming off of Christmas season where we celebrate Emmanuel, God is with us. And there's something about a life that is rich in prayer that makes that idea a reality in our lives. So what would it look like if you resolved to be a man or a woman of prayer? What would it look like a year from now or 10 years from now or 50 years from now if you could look back and say, like, I prayed and I was blessed for it and God moved? We've been using a book, How to Pray, Prayer for Normal People by Peter Grieg. It's a great resource. If you'd like to go deeper, I cannot recommend it enough. It's a good book. It has a lot of cool resources. And we've been using an acronym from the book to talk about prayer, P-R-A-Y. Memorable, yes, because it spells what? pray. Yeah, there you go. and it stands for, thank you, Spencer, pause, rejoice, ask, and yield. Pause, rejoice, ask, and yield. This is the third week, so what are we on this week? Ask, right? We talked about P for pause, about how really, and I think this is true, to grow in our prayer life, we have to create spaces and times to pray. They don't have to be huge or extravagant or long, but they do have to be intentional, and they do have to be carved out of our day. You know, I think sometimes we think like, oh, I don't have time to pray, but like we literally have time for so many things during the week. How many of you guys does your phone give you once a week of how many hours you've been on your phone screen time update? It's like I feel the condemnation of the Lord every time that pops on my screen, right? Like we all have plenty of time in our lives, right? Let's use some of it to pray and create those times and spaces. Last week we talked about R for what? Rejoice. And we talked about how this is something where if we can become people who rejoice and praise God and look to God and honor God and remember God often in prayer, how it sets our relationship for the requests that are normally the biggest part of our prayer. It helps us fix our eyes on who we are praying to, right? And then we're not just, wish casting out into the world, but like we're praying to Jesus and we're praying to God the Father who loves us and created us and the sovereign God of the world. Who are we praying to? And it locates us in our relationship with him. I really think a spirit of adoration and rejoicing and thinking and honoring of God, it shifts our heart, right? We talked about some tools for last week about practicing the presence of God. That'll shift your heart. If you can bounce your heart into prayer throughout your day, it'll change some things big time. We talked last week the tool about praying through the Psalms is another tool that can really shift your heart. And it's one of the best tools, I think, to learn how to pray because we use the words of the psalmists that have been used for centuries and centuries and centuries. That last song we just sang, Creating Me a Clean Heart, O God, is a psalm. And you could go out and find a ton of psalms that are put to scripture and put to music, and they you'll remember them. There's a Christian guitar duo called Shane and Shane. They have like 45 CDs of psalms. To me, that might be an exaggeration, but maybe not. I don't know. There's so many out there, and they're great. This week, we're going to be on ask, and I think this is what most people think about when they think about prayer is we're asking God for something we need, often in a moment of desperation or a moment of need. Almost universally, if you say what is prayer, people would say asking God for help. Right? This is what we think about when most of us think about praying. We think about asking God for things. And so we're going to talk about that today. Kind of like it's kind of a 10,000 feet view. There's so many, we could literally preach on this for a year, I think, about how we ask of God. And there's so many scriptures we can unpack. And we're gonna go through a lot of things quickly here today and maybe dig in a little bit more later in this series. But this is a place, if you're taking notes today, if there's some scriptures that stand out to you, that you could go back and you could do some inductive Bible study. You could do some digging in on these different scriptures and to seek a richer understanding of how God invites us to ask. But I'm going to go kind of from a more general, kind of covering a lot of territory angle today on this. I hope it's helpful. The goal here is I hope to draw you into a place where you feel like you can ask God to do things in your life and believe that it's possible and believe that he wants to and intends to work in your life. And I hope put together that God wants us to ask for things. I think sometimes we think that like, oh, we can all, I used to think about this analogy a lot. I think sometimes we think of God as like one of those things on the wall where it's like, there's like a fire hose and sometimes there used to be an axe in there and they've kind of stopped doing that because of murderers and stuff, but like a hose, and it's behind glass, and there's a little hammer. What does it say? Break glass in case of emergency. Like, I think sometimes that's how we think of prayer, that, like, it's this thing where, like, grandma's sick, I hurt myself, my marriage is falling apart, like this is when I get to pray, is, like, in case of emergency. Otherwise, I don't want to bother God, but I hope kind of my goal today is to say, like, I think God wants us to ask him for stuff with greater frequency. I think it's pretty clear And it's a cool invitation from Jesus to pray that way. So we're going to talk about a couple things. Why do we ask? This is where we're going to start. Why do we ask? I'm going to give you three things. There's not slides for these, so if you're taking notes or you want to use this in your small group later, write them down. Number one, why do we ask in prayer? First thing, Jesus modeled it, right? Jesus taught us how to pray, and this is, you know, we spent some time with each one of these requests in our series last fall as we taught on the Lord's Prayer. There are many and several petitions, another word for ask, right, in that prayer. And that's how Jesus taught us to pray. You know, the most common would be, give us this day what? Our daily bread. But there's also, God, forgive us. God, lead us not to temptation. God, deliver us from evil. Give us, forgive us, lead us, deliver us. Those are all asks, aren't they? And God said we could pray those every day. Give us our daily bread. Deliver us from evil today. Forgive us of my sin today. Lead us not into temptation today. Deliver us from evil today, right? Jesus taught us that we can ask, and I love that the first one, you know, deliver us from evil, sounds kind of like one of those break glass in case of emergency things, right? Like I'm picturing like vampires and werewolves or something, you know, but like give us our daily bread sounds ridiculously ordinary, doesn't it? Like give us our daily bread, give us our daily needs. I love that Jesus has that as like the first petition, because I believe that that's an invitation that we can pray for like normal, ordinary, everyday, boring, white bread kind of stuff, right? We don't just have to ask God for the big, ridiculous things in our life. In fact, I think if we ask for small things from God, it gives us far more opportunities to see God at work in our lives, more opportunities for gratitude and praise, right? And Jesus talked a lot about asking of the Father. He said, ask me for anything in my name, and I'll do it. That's why we pray in Jesus' name. He said, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you'll find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. Jesus clearly asked God for lots of things, and he invites us to do the same. I think if we only ask God for those break glass kind of moments, we'll only expect God to do the big things in our life, and we'll miss out on many of the ways that which God would want to bless us and show us his presence, right? I think God is doing a lot of things in our life, and we miss them sometimes because we're not asking, and so we're not seeing his hand in our life. There's a quote from the book about praying for little things that I liked. I wanted to share it with you. It says this, filling our days with tiny prayers makes us relinquish our sense of entitlement and receive each detail of our day as a blessing, each coincidence as a minor miracle. And we train our brain, we train our neural pathways to rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Jesus Christ. Pray for little things. It's a challenge. Try it for a week. See how it might help you to see and rejoice in the way God is working in your life. Why do we ask? Because Jesus told us to pray for our daily bread, right? Number two, why do we ask? We ask because we as Christian people, right, church, we believe that God changes things. If we didn't, we would never pray. If we didn't, why would we worship? If we didn't believe that God was a God who interfered and intervened and worked in our world, it's fundamental in what it means to be a Christian, right? The Bible, from creation to Revelation, is filled with stories of God intervening and changing the course of events for man. It's chock full of them. You cannot read the Bible without seeing God interfere and intervene and work in the lives of humans, right? He interrupts us. He changes and challenges like the laws of physics and nature. This is what is at the center of Christianity. We're going to take communion today. Hopefully, I think we have enough communion cups. we're running a little low. But at the center of what it means to worship, at the center of the church is this practice of communion, where literally every time we take the bread and the wine, every time we take the cup, we are celebrating that God is a God who intervenes at the most fundamental level of what it means to be human, a God who raised Jesus from the dead, that would not have happened, but God chose to raise Jesus from the dead. And he raised Jesus from the dead, and he anointed him to power. And he raised Jesus from the dead. And he said that sacrifice was acceptable for the sins of humanity. And he raised Jesus from the dead. And we get to participate in the sacrifice and the new life that is found in Jesus. Every time we come to the table, we are affirming that we pray to a God who can change things. At a molecular, divine level, God interferes with humans. Why not pray? This is why we ask of God. Number three, why do we ask of God? I've been thinking a lot about this one this week. We ask of God because it is a ridiculous and absurd, mind-blowing privilege that we get to. It is a privilege to pray. It is amazing that God lets us pray. Because think about this. God is all-knowing. We're never informing God of anything that he doesn't know, right? When we bring our request to God, God already knows them. We're not ever informing God of anything because God is all-knowing. We're never giving God wisdom or counsel, right? We're never making God go, oh, you know what? I didn't think about it that way, Kyle. You are so smart, right? Like that is not what's happening, right? God is not a father whom we have to like logic to and change his divine intuition, right? We're never informing or greater than the wisdom of God. Romans 11, 34 to 36 says this, for who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor? Isn't that crazy to think? We pray that way sometimes. Who has given God a gift that he might be repaid? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Right? Who's God's counselor? Who's informing God? This is true. This is fundamentally true. God is sovereign and powerful and all-knowing, and we are not. And this is what blows my mind. Still, God invites us to pray. And we believe that as we pray, it changes things in the world. That's insane. That God would allow humanity to, in any way, any spark of a way, partner with his will for the world and participate in what happens, participate in how the world changes because we pray, is a ridiculous, astonishing, astounding miracle. God changes things because humans pray. He doesn't have to, but it is one of the ways in which God has intertwined himself with us. And it's nuts. It's nuts burgers, right? Like, it's just crazy. Why do we pray? Because it's a ridiculous privilege to do so. God has ordained that prayer has impact on real events. James wrote in chapter 4, you do not have because you do not ask. Prayer causes things to happen that wouldn't otherwise happen in the world. And it's a crazy privilege to believe as Christian people that some of the things that happen in the world as God moves and works happen because humans prayed. And if we don't participate in that, I think we're missing out on some of the miraculous things that God wants to do in us and through us as the people of God. It's binary, right? Either prayer has no impact on the world, God already knows and he's sovereign and he will just do whatever he wants, right? And we could believe that. It's either that or prayer actually makes a difference. Prayer shifts what God will and wants to do in the world. Prayer changes what happens in the world. It can only be one of those two things. Either prayer makes no difference and God is sovereign, or prayer does make a difference and it shifts things. And I live over here purely, 100%, because of what Jesus, God's best revelation of himself, told his followers. He said, you pray in my name. He said, ask, knock, and receive. And those are words that say, keep on asking, keep on knocking, keep on inquiring, keep on saying, yes, 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 I will pray. I'm gonna exist over here. It's hard for me to believe that sometimes. But the alternative is saying, I don't think it makes any difference. And I can't get there because of what Jesus said about prayer. And the invitations he gives us to pray for things as small as daily bread. So we're invited to ask. That's what's so exciting. How do we ask? It's because at the heart of this is our participation. I do have slides for these. I'm going to give you three again. How do we ask? We ask in a way, number one, that is relational. We ask in our relationship with Jesus, right? We pray in Jesus' name. We pray as sons and daughters of Jesus who have received forgiveness for our sins and find ourselves in relationship with Jesus, co-heirs with Christ, sons and daughters of the King, at a seat at the table. We pray as the prodigal son and the prodigal daughter return to the Father. We pray knowing God loves us. We pray knowing that Jesus gave himself up for us on the cross. We pray in that relationship with Jesus and not separate from it at all, right? So when you ask God, it's not wishing. It's not just being positive. I do not like the expression thoughts and prayers because your thoughts do nothing, right? It is we're praying in relationship and we're praying to Jesus specifically, right? Prayers are in the context of a relationship. We're asking God. We're asking God the Creator. We're asking Sovereign Lord. We're asking God to reveal himself through Jesus who made himself accessible and known. We're asking God who promised us that when he left, he would give us the Holy Spirit who is like being with Jesus in the flesh. We talked about rejoicing last week. This is why the rejoicing and the adoration and the acknowledging to whom we pray and the setting ourselves in that relationship is absolutely essential and critical because prayer is relational. We pray to Jesus. We pray in Jesus' name. We pray to our God. We pray with the power of the Holy Spirit. We cannot separate ourselves from who we pray to. Prayer is relational. And God wants to know us. There's a really cool story in Mark chapter 5. You could go and read this and dig into this a little bit where Jesus is walking through a crowd and a woman who some say like is hemorrhaging or she has an issue where she keeps bleeding and she can't, no doctors have been able to help her. And there's a story where Jesus is walking through a crowd and this woman reaches out and she grabs his robe and Jesus, it says, it feels the power go out of him and she is healed. And you get this impression where this moment of healing happened and then the crowd pushed Jesus away. Then he fights back through the crowd because Jesus wants to know who she is and he wants to look her in the face and he wants to tell her that her faith has made her whole. And he's not willing to do something for her apart from this relationship. The healing happened, but Jesus said, no, the relationship matters too. And so he went back and he identified her and he spoke to her, right? All of our prayer, gang, all of our requests to God are because of our relationship with him, right? When we ask of God, number two, we ask in a way that is vulnerable. We ask with vulnerability. To ask of God is to admit that we need something. We need something that's outside of ourselves. And it, again, go back to last week. It sets us in a relationship, God and not God, right? We ask because we believe that God has the power and will to do things in our life and in our world that we cannot see and make happen by our own hand and our own power. Ultimately, this is an aspect of our faith, right? Anytime we ask of someone, we're putting some faith that they have the power, the ability to do what we need, right? If you ask someone to babysit your children, you're having quite a bit of faith that those kids are going to be like alive and well and not have many broken bones when you return, right? You got to put some trust in that person. You ask your doctor to help like diagnose you and heal you. You're putting some faith that they know what to do. When you pray to God with your requests, it's an acknowledgement that like, God, we need some help here, right? And you cannot pray without being vulnerable. You can't ask without being real about what you need. I think this is hard in an age of skepticism, in an age where, you know, we don't see God standing there next to us and talking to us, and we don't know his degrees or what, you know, like this is tough, but it is a place where God meets us and grows our faith. I think asking for things every day grows our faith because, you know what, you will see God start to answer some of those prayers in your life. You got to ask to see God move in your life. I believe that. Sometimes God will move in your life because other people have asked, right? But I think the practice of asking for yourself is good, and asking for others is a good thing to do. Faith is found in knowing Jesus. This is why we rejoice. It's inseparable. And so as we pray and we are vulnerable and we ask for these things, it's a thing that can build our faith, because there's something intimate about praying to God and being vulnerable before Him. I think it's also why we invest in that relationship and we get to know Him and we pray the Psalms and we read His Word and we participate in weekly worship and we take communion, because we're asking Jesus for these things in a vulnerable way and we're putting ourselves in a relationship with Him. Hebrews 12 says, we fix our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. And so you might feel silly to pray. You might feel like you don't have enough faith to pray. You might feel like you need to grow in faith before you can ask God to move and work in your life. I'd flip that around on you and say, if you want to grow in your faith of God, start to ask Him for some things in your life. Start to pray some requests. Start to put belief, you know, put some trust. It is the action of taking that step that will build some faith over time. I really do believe that. So it's relational and it's vulnerable in the sense that it might feel risky. It might feel like you're putting yourself out there. Guess what? You are. You're asking God to do something you can't do. That's okay. Number three, we pray in this way that is very intentional. We pray with intentionality, right? To pause and rejoice and ask of God is a choice. It's an act. It's a place where we use our free will. God doesn't just ride roughshod over our lives. He doesn't just do things, always against our will. Like God is sovereign, but there is this tremendous place that will and free will plays in the life of every human and certainly every believer. And so to ask God for something is activation of our will, right? It's a place where our ability to choose shows up. I think God respects our free will. I think He loves us enough to not force things over us. And so, you know, as you pray for a greater faith, as you pray for holiness, as you pray for God to come and work in your life, as you pray for your marriage, or you pray for your children, you pray for your job, you pray for your ministry, you pray for opportunities that God gives you to build His kingdom, I think prayer is one of those places where our free will meets with God's power, and God uses the choices that we make in prayer to affect the choices and outcomes in other places of our life. Where do we affect the free will lever of our hearts? I think in prayer is one of the places where we put our palms up and we say, God, this is what I'm asking you to do, because this is what I'm willing to do. And I hope this is what you're willing to do. And I hope together we can do this thing, or this thing will shift, or this thing will move. I've seen way too many prayer requests pan out, come true, change, become a reality, to not believe that prayer makes a difference, and to not believe that God asks us to put our heart and will into prayer. God loves us. We're not His forceful subjects. He invites us to participate in His work. And I believe it really makes a difference. There's a quote that could spend you an evening of kind of mind-bending reality and thinking from Karl Barth, and it says this: God does not act the same way whether we pray or not. Oh, God does not act the same way whether we pray or not. If we believe that prayer makes a difference, we believe that the actions of God, by His, not by our force, but by His gracious willingness, that events in history change because we pray. It's a pretty ridiculous invitation. I think Scripture is abundantly clear. It invites us to ask, and it invites us to ask again and again and again. It invites us to put our will and our heart into it. It invites us to be vulnerable and authentic and real before God. We're invited to ask about the biggest things in our life and the smallest, everything from our greatest pains and heartbreaks to our daily bread. We are invited to ask. And I think the challenge here at the beginning of the year, as we're talking about this prayer series, my gut says that this is a privilege that we don't take advantage of as much as we could. The privilege it is to ask God to help us. In the last week, we talked about the presence of God. We talked about praying all the time, praying before every conversation, every meal, every drive, every day of work, every project. Why wouldn't we ask that God would pour out his blessing and his wisdom? Why wouldn't we ask God to make us more loving and kind and patient? Why wouldn't we ask God for to be in our marriage? Why wouldn't we ask God to bless and lead and shape the hearts of our children? Why wouldn't we pray for presidents, whether we like them or not? Why wouldn't we pray for our city? Why wouldn't we pray for our kids' teachers? Why wouldn't we pray for one another? Why wouldn't we pray that God would come and move in our church? Like all of these things that you can think of seem like reasonable things to pray for, don't they? I'm sure you've got some things flashing through your head right now. And the point of today's sermon is, you know what? God 100% invites you to ask for things. Isn't that crazy? The tool that we're going to hand out today at the end is how to maintain a prayer list. And the cool thing about a prayer list is there are 1,000 things you could pray for, right? A prayer list is a really cool way to, I think, not get overwhelmed by what you pray for. How many of you guys have kept a prayer list before? Probably quite a few of you, you know? And it's a habit that we can go in and out of. And I would say I recommend, as we're in this series, to try this week just for a little bit and see what it does. With a prayer list, what you can do is you can kind of, you can say, this day I'm going to pray for these things, and this day I'm going to pray for these things. And it allows you to kind of have a place to land all of the prayers that are on your heart for people and things in your world without necessarily feeling like you have to just sit still and pray for everything you can think of before you get up and do something else, right? You can pray for a couple things on Monday and a couple things on Tuesday. And it's also a place where when you consult your prayer list with some frequency, maybe as a part of your morning quiet time, maybe over your lunch break, maybe on your commute, although, you know, be careful not to keep your eyes open. It can kind of jog your memory of, these are things that God has invited me to ask for and to pray, right? Sometimes I also think we kind of think like, oh, you know, it's kind of like the telling someone I'll pray for you and then you just never remember it, right? Sometimes I think we think that like thinking about praying is praying. No, you got to pray. You got to ask God, right? This isn't wishing, it's praying. And so we're going to send this home with you. It's just a way to think about with some clear instructions about how to build a prayer list. Those of you that are watching online, I'll make sure that Nathan will have this later today. Hopefully we'll get it up on the website by tomorrow at the latest, but we'll have it there for you as well. But as we think about praying and asking God for his requests, I want to share with you one more story, and it's, I think when you look at all the scriptures that Jesus shared about praying, you look at the Lord's Prayer, you look at the invitation for daily bread, you look at asking my name, you look at all the things Jesus said, I think it's abundantly clear that we get to ask God for things and that God cares and that God will respond and change the world by prayers of people who have faith in him. I think it's true. But my favorite thing is this story in Luke 18, because I think it sets the tone for what that looks like. And it's a story in Luke 18. It is called the Parable of the Persistent Widow. I'm going to read the whole thing to you because it's only 8 verses. It says this: Jesus told them a parable to the effect that they ought to always pray and not lose heart. So how do we ask? This is it. We pray in a way that we should always ask and that we should not be discouraged in our asking, right? And it says this. He tells this parable, a story. He says, in a certain city, there was a judge who neither feared God nor respected man. And there was a widow in that city who kept coming to him and saying, Judge, give me justice against my adversary. For a while, the judge refused. But afterward, he said to himself, though I neither fear God nor respect man, yet this widow keeps bothering me. I will give her justice so that she will not beat me down by her continual coming. This is the best story. So if you are a persistent old lady, be encouraged. And the Lord said this after the story. He said, hear what the unrighteous judge says, and then will not God give justice to his elect, to his chosen, to his people who cry to him day and night? Will God delay long over them? I tell you, he will give justice to them speedily. It's an interesting idea, and there are all kinds of deep and difficult questions with how and when will God answer prayer, and what happens when God doesn't answer our prayer, and we're going to get into some of those in this series. But just for this week, I want to invite you to be someone who asks God to move and work in your life, and try it and build it as a life habit. I think when I read that story in Luke 18, that Jesus is inviting us to pray to God, and the widow might be characterized as naggy or kind of someone that's not a good character, but Jesus is using the story to say, no, you know what? You might think you cannot ask of God. I'm saying ask of God and ask of God and ask of God, because he loves you and he cares for you and he listens, and prayer makes a difference. And I think, like many things in our spiritual life, there is something built here by habit and repetition. The story would back that. There's a story in the book towards the end of this chapter on petition about a pastor, D.L. Moody. D.L. Moody had a prayer list for 100 people in his life that were not Christian people that he made when he was fairly young, and he prayed for them every day. And by the time that he died, 96 of them had given their lives to the Lord. It's kind of crazy. 100 people on his prayer list, and 96 of them by the time he died had given their lives to God. And it had changed their lives. At his funeral, the last 4 got saved. It's crazy. It's a cool story. And I could picture him praying every day for people for years and years and years and seeing no change in their life. And yet, he kept praying. God invites us to ask. He invites us to ask over and over and over again. He invites us to pray with persistence. He invites us to pray about big things, and he invites us to pray about little things. And if you take anything away from the sermon today, that's it. You are invited to ask God to move and work in your life, in the lives of the world, in the lives of people around you. Amen? Shay, do we have enough communion cups to do communion today? We do. I got a thumbs up. So we're going to distribute the elements right now. I'm going to invite Nathan to come back up and to participate. If you're at home, I'd invite you just to make this a moment of prayer and resolution in your life, you know. So if you can just, you know, quiet yourself, if you're multitasking, maybe stop, and just take a moment here. We're going to pray together as we close out our service. For those of you that are here and in the room, we're gonna receive communion together. Hopefully we'll have enough for everybody, and we'll go from there. So, Nathan, will you play for us? And we'll just, while we distribute, we'll just take a quiet moment of just contemplation and prayer, and then in a moment we'll receive the elements together. Please stick your hand up if you still need communion. Shay, I'll take one if everyone else has been served. Is there one left? Nathan and I will share. I'm just kidding. This one's for you, bud, all right? Friends, every time we come and we receive the Lord's Supper, we are celebrating that God interferes with humanity at the most extraordinary level, right? God raised Jesus from the dead. Completely, fully dead. And if God can raise Jesus from the dead, And if God invites us into a relationship with him in the same manner that we believe that we will be raised from the dead, that's the most extreme thing I can think about asking of God, and he's already promised to do it. And so I think we're invited to ask about other things. So today we're going to receive the bread and the wine. So you go ahead and take your cracker out of the bottom. Go ahead. Jesus with his disciples at the last meal took a piece of bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body broken for you." Whenever we receive it, we remember that we receive now and remember the sacrifice of Jesus as his body was broken. Flip your cup over and open it. That's very important. In the same way, at the same meal, Jesus took a cup. He said, "This is my blood poured out for you, the blood of the new covenant." The promise that God is making here is incredible. And so we receive this cup and we remember the blood of Christ and the promise that Jesus made us. We are his sons and his daughters. We participate in life with God who changes things. We receive together. We pray for you and pray for you at home. God, it's incredible. It does not seem real, fair, or possible that our prayers would make any difference in the world. But the message in the New Testament, the message from Jesus again and again and again is yeah, go ahead and ask. Ask of me. Ask like a persistent widow. Ask for daily bread. Ask for deliverance. Ask for freedom. Ask for forgiveness. Jesus, you invite us to ask. And God, help us be kids who listen to their father. Help us be kids who take this to heart and ask with freedom and ask with faith and ask with belief that you're going to move and work. Lord, will you continue to stir our hearts for prayer with resolve and hope and faith in a new way? That's my request of you, God, today. Will you stir our hearts to be people who come and ask boldly at the throne? Jesus, you love us. Be with us as we go from this place. We ask this of you. We ask that you send us out of here with fire in our bellies, with hope, with faith. God, we ask that it would be representations of you in our homes and our workplaces. Lord, we ask that you would lead us and guide us. Lord, we ask for wisdom. We ask for hope. We ask for healing. And we ask a God, Father, who gives good gifts to his children whom he loves. Jesus, you told a story about a man who gave bread to his kids. He said, "What father, if a son asked for bread, would give him a snake?" God, you want to give us bread. Help us ask for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We stand for the benediction. This is from your prayer list tool, Philippians 4:6. "Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, by prayer and asking with thanksgiving, freely present your requests to God." Go in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit and be people who heart and mind actively and willfully and faithfully, frequently goes to prayer. In Jesus' name, you are sent. Thank you for being with us online. Hope to see you again soon. We love you guys. Have a good week.
Transgressions now. Wash me, make me cleanse, oh cleanse me from my sin. Yeah, yeah. My transgressions I confess, grief and guilt my soul oppress. I have sinned against thy grace and provoked thee to thy face. And I confess thy judgment just, speech aside thy mercy trust. Yeah. To my heart and make me pure, thy grace bestow, wash me whiter than the snow. Gracious God, by thy wrath and judgment just, let my contrite heart rejoice, and in gladness hear thy voice. From my sins, oh, hide thy face, and blot them out in boundless grace.